Hey everyone, my name is David Hogreff. I'm going to be starting off this morning, teaching this morning, and we'll be talking about tracking and fire in your permaculture design. So fire suppression and fire awareness. And you'll find that tracking and awareness and fire, they all tie right in together. But a little about my background. I started when I was 20 years old with the Florida Park Service as a park ranger, mostly in wildland fire on a fire module for Southwest Florida. Did that for 10 years and then got an opportunity to go over to Africa and live in South Sudan. So I quit my job, traveled with a one-way ticket over to South Sudan, not sure when I'd come back, and volunteered with a bunch of NGOs to go over there and do tactical burnouts around their compounds. So where I went over there, these NGOs were trying to go in, and an NGO is a non-government organization, like Doctors Without Borders, Red Cross, Pioneers. And they're going in to stabilize the region. The three big issues they came upon were security, water, and fire. Well, of course, fire was my interest, so I went in on that. I'm like, well, how could I help you on that? How can I come over and see if I can help you? But as it gets dry and they start burning the rest of the fields, they let it run. It's not like the States where we have to do a prescribed burn, you call it in, you have a plan, you keep it in your box. Their box there is the entire country. Just let it go. So a village over here, they see the fire coming, they realize they have 2 days. They start gathering their fields, their crops, putting a fire ring around their property and burning out. But now NGOs come in, you got doctors and engineers and scientists, and they're not firefighters. They didn't know it's their responsibility to stop this fire. And then they'd keep walking, and I remember one guy, he had a box of matches, and we walked about 20 kilometers that day, and about every kilometer or so, he would drop a match. He's like, it'll be much easier when we come back through. I'm like, oh, it probably will be. And then you just see it ripping off over here, and I'm like, I had to look at my map. I'm like, okay, no NGOs over there, but there's one up here. So, like, I had to cut away and go burn around with them. And after that, I started my own nonprofit to actually go back and start setting up a preserve in the same areas we were burning. So we have tribal elders on our nonprofit, and they now own the land through the nonprofit. They've always owned it themselves. The big risk they had, and the reason I did it, is China has come into most of these areas and bought up massive amounts of land. Millions, about 1.4 million acres in South Sudan and most of Uganda. They have mineral rights to almost the whole country. And so we went in there to keep the tribes and help protect them, just put it underneath our nonprofit and give them more of a paper protection, because it's the same as the Native Americans had. There's no deed or title. The tribe knows this is his property, that's their property. See that tree? That's the boundary for four properties. There's no markers or anything. And by putting it underneath the nonprofit, at least it has Western protection. They can tell you every medicinal, edible, and useful plant for 50 miles from their property. Phenomenal. I mean, there's a little 13-year-old girl. I wrote 16 pages of notes from what she knew of that area. I'm like, she has a PhD in this stuff. It's incredible, but that's how they live. So now I've got about 14 and a half years in under my belt doing that, and I'll be teaching you guys a little bit today. We're not going to be like teaching you to go out and fight massive wildfires, but we want to tie it in as a permaculturalist, as a firefighter, and as a tracker on how you can use this if you're building your own farm or even your own property. But we'll do a little bit of that today, and I'm also going to today what you have around your property. If you ever get fire on your farm, how to protect it. And so say this is your residence here, and if you're going to do a design, and you've probably been talking some about this already this week, about your designing your layout, especially if you have the choice. They'll throw palm branches and some wet mud on the outside and burn logs under it for about 3 days, and that makes fire-glazed bricks. So the best way to stop fire, there's what's called the fire triangle. A fire triangle is heat, oxygen, and fuel. If you take one of those legs out, the fire will die. One of the simplest ways is removing the fuel or changing the fuel type. With fire, especially in Florida, dealing, this is the ecosystem we're looking at, we have many different ecosystems here, but only a handful of them are actually the fire type. Now, those ecosystems do cover most of Florida. 66% of Florida is fuel model 7, which is pine flatwoods. So you have your mature slash pine longleaf overstory and an understory of palmetto, gallberry, wiregrass, and a mix of flowers and vines. With this, I want to transition, and feel free to ask fire questions as we go, but I'm going to transition into a little overview on tracking so that when we get into the field, you'll have a little layout of it. And some people are like, why would I even need to learn tracking? Why would I need to know anything about this? You know, it's not as useful nowadays. We have technology, we have planes, we have infrared and night vision and all this. Well, tracking isn't just about following an animal or a person. Tracking is awareness of your surrounding, and you can't separate tracking and awareness. And to even just tie it right into fire, we do a course called Fire Investigation. And when we do that, it's looking at a fire that started even after it's out. And how did it start? And you can get to where the soil is and actually read the pressure releases through all the leaves. It's a job. But Tom Brown has a story actually in one of his books. It's the case files of a tracker. And in that book, he tells a story of there was this murder case from years and years ago. They never were able to find the guy. Tom ended up going out there afterwards and was wandering around. He went to the spot that they knew they had a footprint. And he just sort of dug down and dug down, layer after layer. And this had been an area covered by a hammock. and it was actually still there years later. It was like a clay soil, and it actually preserved the footprint. It had worn down a lot. But he got to the bottom, and he could read the press releases, and he saw that in it there was the motion of this. Somebody had thrown something, and they had never found the knife that was the murder weapon. And he saw there was a pond ahead, so he followed it by judging how approximately far in the direction it went, and 30 minutes later came out with a knife. It was a bayonet. But there was a possum that was going in and out of this last time, and I could tell by the tracks that were coming out. One thing you can look at it now is see all the leaves that have flown in, and the fact that that hose was laying right across over here definitely hasn't been here recently. But even 2 weeks ago, his print is still here. You know where we were saying if you want to catch tracks, so a track catch, this is a great spot for it. It's a natural trail, natural funnel. You've got your brush and your gardens over here. You got a fence here. People are naturally going to follow these because it's a little civil trail, but so are animals. But then a tracking box, a lot of times, will just take a board. But you can take your hands, you can take a rake, and when you're working on an area, smooth it all out, get as much debris out of it as you can. And this is plenty long. Longer trails are great because then you can do running prints and everything. Here, you have to aim for them. But if you're going to go and look for what's going on in an area, you can just do a simple walk where I walk through it. And just walk normal, looking up, last one looking down. And then this is where you start getting into more your press releases and reading the track. We also have modern medicine here, you know, and all that. But I always like to teach both sides of it. It's like with plants. A lot of times the most poisonous plants are the best medicine, but it's in a small dose for the right cause. And so sometimes the deadliest plants are great to have around. A lot of times people are like, oh, I hate this plant, I hate this plant. Oh, that's toxic, don't let my kids get near it. But yet, to herbalists, that's probably some of the best medicine if you have a serious issue. Sometimes the same plant that causes it, used differently, can heal it. And another thing that Tom teaches, and I found even out west, I got a good story about that, and I'll finish with this one, is that within 6 feet of the plant that causes the poison or the problem is the solution, the solvent to it. So your countersolve, nature always has it, unless it's a very disturbed site, but in a natural setting. So you have poison ivy. In Florida, one of the best ones, again, for it is usually it's somewhere around an oak tree. The acorns or any of the tannic acid from that oak tree is the best solution to poison ivy.